time data, and we have some time at your models, and we can train it into the data. But it's not hard to see that for most types of lenses, we don't get much out of direct modeling in terms of studying the masks. And the reason is that if we don't use direct modeling to do profile studies, we don't need to use any enough constraints to cover all the three parameters in our model, specifically the profile parameter, it could be a full, it could be a full radius, whatever. The second thing is you really need images to follow multiple radii. That's kind of intuitive. If you want to study how mass is distributed radially, you have to make some measurements at different radii. So for typical quads, where we just have four plane images, that's radii, that's plane images, but they're all kind of at the same radii. So that means the most quads are not so useful for studying mass profiles. Typical doubles, well, in a two image lens, we can have two images that are at very different radii from the lens center, which is good, but there's just not enough constraints in the typical doubles. It's really a steady mass profile. So that's kind of disappointing. So in order to apply direct modeling to structural studies, you need special types of lens, and I'll go through other similar examples. One special type of lens is, of course, multiple lens sources, and the prototype for this is Craftsman 1933. It's a radio source that consists of three components, and it's lensed into a total of 10 images. And this has been modeled by Dan Karn and Cindy Monia, and you can constrain the nice parametric model to study the master profile, and I get a 3D profile flow that's consistent with something roughly isothermal. So isothermal would be n equals 2, so density goes like 1 over r squared. And this has been done in a couple of lens systems. The other way to use direct modeling is a special type of lens system, is in systems that have resolved information. So this is a two-image lens system from Kraft, the 1152. And when you look at the images at high resolution using the DLBA, you resolve each of them into a coordinate depth structure. This gives you additional constraints on the mass model. It essentially gives you constraints on the relative magnification matrix. And that's an example of the degeneracy that you otherwise suffer from in modeling a double. And if you look over here, you see that we can actually do quite a nice job of constraining the mass profile of the lens galaxy in the system. And again, we get something that's very close to isothermal. And this technique, this special type of lens system, has been applied in a couple of cases. So you'll notice throughout this talk that I'm going to say the word isothermal a whole lot. The third type of lens system useful for direct modeling constraints is a lens with a central image. So this is A1632, which was discovered by Gottman in his lens capture net, and we believe it to be the first galaxy scale lens with a central image. What's nice about this system is you get three images of three very different radii from the lens center, which means it's proof of studying the mass profile. And if we apply very simple models to this system, we can get great profile constraints. And that's because the depth of the central image depends very sensitively on the profile parameters of the mass model. So if we model with a 3D power of lens, we get a mass model consistent with a little bit shallower than isothermal, that's sort of 1.9. So error bars are almost embarrassingly small. But the problem here is that we can't distinguish a global power law model from a qualitatively different model, one where we have an isothermal profile going to the constant density core. We get great constraints on the core radius in this case, but we can't distinguish this model from this model. And obviously, that's disappointing because we would like to be able to discriminate between models that have very different behaviors at core radius. And that's kind of illustrated here, where we have a model with isothermal large radius, and it breaks to some shallower slope beta at small radius. So the central images, again, this has been applied in nearly only one or two systems so far. So if I had an optical image here, the lens would be right about here. So I should have brought an optical image here. So it's possible that in the future we will find central image systems where you can distinguish between something like a power law model and a core model, but these are my simulations, I'm not as sensitive about that. And overall, there's about 5 to 10 lenses in which we have some sort of profile constraint based on direct modeling. So that's one very important technique that we use for studying the structures of lens galaxies. We've looked into that in great detail. What is constant at the most? And we don't have any big candidates for what is constant, other in terms of physical parameters. We're going to reproduce the proper magnification of the central image, which depends very sensitively on the model. We have to pass the critical curve within some certain distance from the image to give it the proper magnification. This is something that's I think still a work in progress. We need some more theoretical understanding of central image systems and what they can actually tell. We only have one galaxy scale lens with a central image, so perhaps when we get more, that'll motivate us to do better analysis. Hopefully, we'll get our final two. So, in terms of studying mass profiles, direct modeling is kind of a mixed bag, but you get a lot more when you add dynamics to the picture. And you're going to hear much about this over the next couple of days from Leon and Samantha, but I'll just give you one slide introduction of this technique. The big idea here is that velocity dispersion is very sensitive to the mass profile under the condition that you have to normalize a given model to reproduce the aperture mass constraint that's given by the lens image geometry. So, if you imagine you have any regular galaxy, and you go out and you measure a central velocity dispersion, that doesn't tell you anything about the mass profile. That's because you have the freedom to take any mass profile you want and normalize it however you want, and we can reproduce the same velocity dispersion. However, in a mass surveillance system, you don't have that freedom. Any mass profile you look at has to be normalized such that it reproduces the proper image within the system. And under those conditions, the velocity dispersion becomes a very powerful discriminator of what the mass profile is in the galaxy. So there's this survey which we'll hear about more later, called the Lens Structure Dynamics Survey, and they've done velocity dispersion measurements on a whole number of lenses, and what you see here is, wow, we have a lot of lenses that look like they're isothermal. So this is nice because it's interesting with the results you get from this plain old model. Another technique that I've introduced along with Chris Kachanik in recent years involves a specific focus on an entire lens ensemble. Our specific idea is to make use of very basic observational properties of the system, to combine them in a clever way to be able to constrain the sort of global mass profile of the lens population as a whole. Another method is to use some astral masses that you get from the image geometry, and the basic optical properties of the lens, such as their luminosity and their effective rate. This technique is nice because it allows you to incorporate large lenses. You know, you don't need special lenses for modeling purposes, and you don't need to go out and get dynamical data, which can be very time consuming. And of course, it's based on very simple lens properties. The disadvantages of statistical models in general, of course, is that you can't say anything about individual lens galaxies. You can only ascribe to the overall properties of the population. So the technique we came up with, which I hope will get more interest in the future as more lenses are being discovered, makes use of aperture masses. So it's not hard to see how aperture masses can be used to trace the mass profile in our galaxy. Now let's imagine we have a parallel galaxy with a density like this, and we have a source behind it, and a source is length into Einstein ring of this radius right here. Now, of course, whenever you have an Einstein ring, you know the mapping thing. That's one thing I want. Now, you can do a little experiment where you move the galaxy now to a different lens, and that creates a different lens, a lens with a different Einstein ring. And it's different not just in angle, it's different in full context. Which means that as you move this galaxy around, you code the enclosed mass on different scales. You can imagine moving through a whole bunch of radii, getting the enclosed masses, and tracing the mass profile in that way. So that's a general idea. Of course, we can't do this in practice because there's not God and we can't move galaxies around. However, we can do something similar using an ensemble of lenses. What we need to do is we need to build a model relating mass to light. And so, a simple case is a homologous model, so a similar mass model. So what this means is we can take the optical properties of the lens, pump it through our model to predict the mass profile for that particular lens. We can then see that that gives us an aperture mass, which is consistent with the lens geometry. And we can constrain all the parameters of the model based on those aperture mass radius relations. This is good because the lens sample stands with an order of magnitude in the Einstein radius with respect to effective radius. So our aperture masses code the mass distribution of relatively grand scale. The lens model we use in this analysis is very simple. We have luminous components in the galaxy, given my current profile, some generalized CDM profile with inner scale n, and basically we pump our optical properties into this model, produce the mass profile, and see if it agrees with the aperture mass that we get for each lens in our population. Now, this is electrical image, this panel right here, where we have a very large grid radius for the CDM halo. So essentially, the CDM looks like a power law. And we show constraints in the plane of the CDM density slope and the fraction of dark matter projected. The mass profile is very close to a power law on the scale of several effective radii. It's very close to an isothermal power law. And in the scale 3 limit, we have a profile slope of 2.06 plus or minus 0.17, which again is consistent with all the other lensing results. It's the total mass distribution. So, lensing really only knows about the total mass profile, so that's always what we're going to constrain that. We can't reproduce our results with a modeling which mass traces well. So that's given by this model, this side right here. In fact, where it falls very rapidly, if you go to a dark matter mass factor, from a distributed mass factor of 0, we need at least 30% dark matter inside two effective radii. We don't get an upper limit on that number because the aperture masses are completely happy with having all of the mass in the galaxy into some power law component. Well, what have we learned from all this? The most important thing is that lensing is really powerful. There are a number of techniques to employ on lens galaxies that give consistent results about the properties of those galaxies, which is very, very nice. I can't indicate through these various techniques that lensing galaxies are nearly isothermal on a scale of two effective radii, and therefore that dark matter is an important contributor to the structure over the inner 5 to 10 fold hard time. Obviously, we would like to do more in the future. A good starting point would be more realistic galaxy models, and that's including structural evolution in our galaxies. And in terms of that, of course, we need many more lenses of all types, so we can apply all these different techniques to them. I'm very happy to see the great work done by Adam Bolton in finding 40 or 50 new lenses through his new spectroscopically selected criterion. And there's also going to be new instruments coming online which will help us make use of the old brute force techniques for finding lenses. EDLA and LFST will be very powerful tools problems to finding one. I'm also cheered by the advent of new recording technology for the LBI observation, which vastly increased the sensitivity of radio telescopes, allowing us deeper searches for central images, which is another good way to study mass profiles. And of course, follow-ups are always going to be key. You can find all those new lenses in the world, but in order to turn them into your scientific tool, you need really good imaging data, you need spectroscopic data. So there's certainly going to be a lot of cool stuff you can do with larger lens samples, and a lot to keep grad students and postdocs busy well into the future. So, thanks.
Thanks much. Questions?
So, in the central image, it's also a bit of how you know that the central image is actually an image of the equivalent of the just a million fish.
Okay, so in the case of 1632, the signal up again, we have radio spectra of these three components. They are in sufficient agreement, in a sufficient frequency range, which makes us think that that is a third image. A second factor, which I cannot discount, is if you asked me 5 years ago what I thought the first radio lens system with a central image would look like, I would have drawn something exactly like this. This is an asymmetric two-image lens system. It's the type that's going to most likely produce a central image. All the images are in about about the right place that you would expect for a central image. The fluxes, they look about right, and they agree with the model. So when we published this paper, the HFC imaging that was available wasn't so great. So we had a detection of the galaxy, but we couldn't say whether the galaxy was on the position of C or whether it was off them. The group imaging has shown that the galaxy position was on the position of C, in the right place you would expect it, just for the city of central image. The galaxy is about right here.
I
wouldn't say with 100% confidence that this is a central image. As the other day used to go, I would bet your life on it if I got my life. But there's a consistent set of evidence which is highly suggestive of this being a central image. The ultimate test would be if we could measure correlated variability in the three components. So that would be very powerful piece of evidence that C is in fact radio variable. But that test, I think, is a little while off.
We're easy to see from this, like these moments of three. You know, back when I've been seeing you back when we were talking about cores, they were talking about cores. It seems like we've sort of parsecs. Now you push the core down to n parsecs, something smaller than that, and you're still unhappy to have a data core even smaller than that. I think you should look at the glass as being 90 or 99% full rather than 10 or 1% empty.
I do remember reading those lensing statistics papers in particular that made use of very large core radii, and that certainly this is much smaller than anything you used to see, which is, and it's a very tight constraint, so. I will try my best to improve my optimism. Yeah.
Okay, in the dynamic analysis of local elliptical, we found a number of sequences that have similar data that actually dry, like 30% or so. But we also found some where we couldn't find any evidence for that matter, and it looks like perhaps there are some ellipticals which within those ranges don't have any dark matter. And moreover, we might expect that the population changes a bit with redshift, because it's the lower mass field ellipticals that get added as it comes to the present by Morse and so on, and they tend to be the less dark matter. So if that was the case, then how would this affect the statistics? Would you measure a particular redshift range? Would you measure a particular mass range, or a combination of the two?
Well, the question you point out is when you think about the limitations of doing statistical analysis. Of course, we have some description of the general properties of the whole population rather than individual properties of individual galaxies. When you look at the dynamical results combined with modeling results that are defined by the LSE survey on these web galaxies, just about all of them require dark matter. There are a few, such as PG1115, which has a rather steeper than average mass profile based on the dynamical constraints. That one is more or less consistent with something like a mass constraint of light. It also comes with all those individual lens galaxies that they have, but you see, there seems to be a fair bit of dispersion in the properties. We measure average properties. It's probably much better to be able to look at an individual galaxy and make a little scatter plot. So I have no doubt that there may very well be some variation in this population. And that definitely has to be sorted out as time goes on. Did I answer your question at all?
No.
Well, of course, it is a bit of an apples and oranges comparison. You're talking about very local ellipticals. We're looking at ellipticals that are roughly fit just a half or so, perhaps even that's just one. So we have to be careful about what we claim in terms of applies to intermediate redshift ellipticals. Still didn't answer.
Okay.
can ask a related question on the tree. And then, in case of that, different individual cases, we're limited by the maximum potential of the tree. And then, there in this open, is there a specific analysis sort of still separate from that, or is it a way of thinking about the natural delivery gravity or anything else?
Well, that's interesting. There is some distribution of energy over different galaxies, so it all kind of systematically changes the result of it in the same way, I suppose.
Let me just say that our typical gravitational arcs are well within 100 kiloparsecs, so we thought we were insensitive to the scale radius.
That's an assumption we'll return to later. But initially, this is what we did with these three parameters. And here's an illustration of our typical response. On the x-axis here, we have the mass to light ratio, the scalar mass to light ratio, the bright cluster galaxy, and the y-axis is this dark matter interstellar data. And these 68, 95, and 99% contours after modularizing with respect to sort of dark matter scale. So as you can see, with hunting alone, we get basically any inner dark matter slope. So once we include the constraints from the velocity dispersion profile of the bright cluster galaxy, the contour shrinks significantly. I try to illustrate why that's the case over here. These hash boxes are the observed velocity dispersion profile of MS-2137. This dashed line corresponds to the expected velocity dispersion profile, the set of three parameters that lies up here. While this solid line corresponds to a set of three parameters that sits down here, that matches both the lensing and the velocity dispersion profile. Okay? So here are the results for the total sample, the six galaxy clusters. Let's keep our eye on the radio lab cluster. Profile, sort of the template we use to measure that, and a lot of those outcomes with matched related to the lensing component of the analysis. We initially compared a simple critical line analysis with a 2D lens model, and we calculated that there's a systematic uncertainty in our measurements of the dark matter interstellar slope of about 0.2. Other studies have taken a closer look at this, and in particular, many et al. Have simulated galaxy clusters and then simulated observations of those related clusters in much the same way that we observe real galaxy clusters. I hope that makes sense. They took simulated clusters and then they long foot down and measured velocity dispersion profile, etc. So they performed our identical analysis, and here is sort of their summary plot. At the function, actually, the ellipticity and the potential of the model down here, and on the y-axis is sort of the observed dark matter inner slope that they found versus the actual inner dark matter slope of the simulation. And as you can see, it seems like one would underpresent the real dark matter slope. So motivated by this, we implemented the generalized NSW profile into John Paul Kinnett's LensCrew software. This lets us account for elasticity in both luminous and dark matter and for perturbing galaxy substructure, and it lets us take into account the full multiple image constraints available from this data. So it helps us out a lot. So for instance, here is the lensing interpretation of MS-2137. I'll show you. Let me step back. In particular, we're going to read the MS-21 and about 2137 and about 383, because those are the two clusters that seem to have the shallow inner dark matter density column. The lensing interpretation for MS-2137, and here it is for about 383. I subtracted a lot of the galaxies, so you can see it better where you are down there. This cluster is a bit more complicated because it does seem to be mildly bimodal. Okay? So let me present these results in two steps. First of all, if you remember, I fixed the scale radius of 400 kilometers with the old analysis. What I'm going to do is rerun our analysis, still keeping the scale radius fixed, but only including our more sophisticated lensing analysis. And then from there, we'll relax the assumption that the scale radius is fixed at 400 kilometers and see what that does to the results. So one step at a time, keeping the scale radius fixed at 400 kilometers, here are the results we get of MS-2137 and about 383 versus the results. We can say the contour really roughly with the delta data points systematically we inferred before, but this one is clearly off. Our new constraints under the dark slope with this fixed scale radius is way off. And we think this is mostly due to the mild bimodality of the cluster, which was not taken into account at all. However, we actually keep the scale radius fixed. First of all, the goodness of fit to the data is not good. So the chi squared is greater than 3 per degree of freedom. And it's well known that the inner dark matter slope is highly degenerate with scale radius. So the lower scale radius you have, the shallower the dark matter slope you're going to infer. This is just because it's treated the same roughly circumstances profile. So what we decided to do is let the scale radius be a free parameter with a classifier in this range. And this range is chosen basically from other data for this cluster and MS-2137. There have been several papers that have found the scale radius between these values. So we bracketed that region in our analysis. But it's also good to keep in mind that in CDM simulations in general, the scale radii in galaxy clusters roughly between 100 and 700 cluster. Okay, so here are the results. When we have a classifier on the scale radius between 50 and 200 kiloparsecs, we seem to favor shallow dark matter in a slope. It must be kept in mind that the best fitting scale radius is very close to constraint. So for instance, if we could fit the scale radius to 200 kiloparsecs, then we would infer a best fitting dark matter in a slope of about 1 up here. So it does depend very strongly on the scale radius prior that we assume. Okay? In addition to this, there are more slight problems. Here's the data when we modulize over all the three parameters. Okay? Except for the dark matter in a slope. We have some tests. However, it is a fit to the velocity dispersion data group. Let's take a look first at about 383. Here's our measured velocity dispersion profile. It's sort of really low signal with noise, a bit of measurement. You know, what do you do? We can do that this narrow velocity dispersion profile is about as good as we can get. Right? However, for NS2137, we see, you know, strong traps of the triangle off the social profile, so we cannot recreate the contact. Well, I think it's fitting the lens is right. So what does this tell us? For instance, Tabazini in 2005 saw a very similar thing in the same cluster, and he suggested that maybe this is due to triaxiality, that we're effectively combining a 2D mass probe lensing with an indirect 3D mass probe across the dispersion profile. And so this may be leading to discrepant results on sort of tangible parsec scales. And there's a number of other reasons for this. Maybe the white sculpting galaxy isn't sitting at the bottom of the cluster potential. It seems to be sort of in the 2D sense.